All right. Hey, good evening, everybody. Go ahead and come on in and grab a seat. We're so glad that you're here tonight. We are just a few days in now to our 21 days of prayer and fasting, and so excited. Already have been hearing some good things from people in their experience as we've been doing this, and so grateful for your participation tonight, and we're ready to worship together. It's going to be a few things that are going to be a little bit different tonight. I'll explain in just a couple of minutes, but as we get started tonight, I know if you're anything like me, your day and your week just kind of gets hectic and busy, and you just kind of sometimes forget to stop and remember that God is good, that He's present with us, that He's available to us. And so so we're just going to begin our time tonight with a few moments of just silence and just kind of processing in the fact that God is real, that He is here, that He is with us, and that He's present in this moment. And so one of the things that's been nice about fasting during this season, even these last few days, has just been when I know that I get hungrier, when I reach for something that I was going to do that I'm cutting out of my life right now, it reminds me, hey, just take some time and stop and just quiet myself before God. And just think on Him and reflect on Him, read His Word, pray, listen for His voice. And so those moments and those times of silence are so important. And so I want to just read one passage of Scripture to you, and then we're going to spend just a few moments in silence, and then we're going to read a passage together. Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 20 says, "The Lord is in His holy temple. Let all the earth be silent before Him." So even in His holy temple, even in His presence, there is silence before God. So we just want to ask you to take a moment in just quiet reflection, just in silence, not praying out to God in this moment. We'll have some times tonight that we'll guide ourselves through prayer. But if you will, just quiet your mind and listen for His voice and just be still before Him. Even if you don't hear Him speak to you in a way that's tangible in this moment, it's okay just to be in His presence and just to be silent with Him. So if you will, just take a few moments and quiet your mind, quiet your heart, and let's be silent before our God. Thanks. And then if you will, would you just stand with me? We're going to read a passage of Scripture together. This should be on the screen for us. This is from Psalm chapter 145. We're going to read verses 1 through 10. And again, we're just preparing ourselves to be in God's presence tonight, listening for Him, reminding ourselves that He's present, that He's near, and that we want to be with Him. So if you will, just read this with me. "I will exalt You, my God, the King. I will praise Your name forever and ever. Every day I will praise You and extol Your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation commends Your works to another. They tell of Your mighty acts. They speak of the glorious splendor of Your majesty. And I will meditate on Your wonderful works. They tell of the power of Your awesome works. And I will proclaim Your great deeds. They celebrate Your abundant goodness and joyfully sing of Your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. The Lord is good to all. He has compassion on all He has made.
All your works praise you, Lord. Your faithful people extol you.
And if you will, just pray with me. Heavenly Father, we just give you glory and honor and praise tonight. God, we know that we are the works of your hands and that you have created all of us. And so as your people, as your creation, we extol you, we praise you, we lift up your name, we positively proclaim that you are God and that you are good and that you are merciful and you are compassionate and you are kind. And we thank you, God, for these reminders, these truths that we read about in Scripture of your nearness to us, that as Creator, it's not random, it's not by chance that we're here, but we are designed and created by you, placed here with purpose, as a part of your design. And we thank you for that. We glorify you for that. And tonight, as we sing together and as we pray together and as we read your word together, God, may our hearts be just churned for your glory, that we would desire more and more of you in depth and knowledge of insight into who you are and what you desire from us and for us. We love you, God, and ask these things all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, stay standing. Here's what we're going to do tonight. MK called a little while ago and told us that she has not been feeling well today and did not want to come and bring any kind of potential sickness around us. So we are going to call a little bit of an audible. We're still going to sing together, but it's going to be through some YouTube videos that we have. So we're going to do some of the music that was already prepared, but we're going to pull it off of some different artists that are going to be doing that. And so you'll see the lyrics on the screen and just encourage you, even though there's not a leader up here on stage, just sing out and make that a part of our celebration tonight. And then we'll continue on, and Andy will lead us through. Thank you.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul. Worship His holy. Song again. is failing, the end draws near, and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then
Thank you. You can be seated. Lord, we love you this morning. We thank you so much that you do offer us your presence. And I pray that what we do in these evenings together is we get a greater sense of your heart to become our hearts, your thoughts to become our thoughts, your ways to become our ways. I'm not sure we can gather really what that means, Lord, but we ask for your presence in our lives, where we live, work, and play. We ask you to help us practice your presence in our lives and see what we can learn and experience tonight in terms of following that. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, thank you guys for being here. For those of you watching from home as well, we're glad that you're joining us in this time where we're seeking his presence. So thank you for being a part of this at home. And as you know from looking at our devotional guide, hopefully you've been following along the last couple of days with that, they're divided, those 21 days are divided up into weekly segments. The first week is about seeking his presence where we live, our homes. The second week is about where we work, and then the third week about where we play. So we've been focusing for the last couple days on seeking his presence where we live, in our homes. And our home has been transformed over the last year and a half because we got a dog. And the first time our family has had one, and it's changed things. And here's one of the things that we've kind of learned, of course, is that your life during the day revolves to some extent around that pet, around that animal. And you start to think about all the things that you do for whether you have a dog or a cat, probably dogs are a little bit more, but there's the feeding and there's the cleaning and there's the bathing and there's the taking to the vet and there's clipping the nails and there's trimming the hair and there's taking it outside and make sure it doesn't go where it's not supposed to outside. And there's dealing with the pets, the neighbor's dogs, and what happens in it relates to your dog. And there's the neighborhood issues, and it's walking down the yard and hoping it doesn't go in somebody's yard. But it's okay to go in this yard, but not that person's yard, you know what I'm saying? And then there's all these other things that go on. Where does it sleep? Where is it not going to sleep? Is it in our bed? Is it in the floor? Is it in somebody else's bed? Where is the dog? Where's the dog at in the morning? Wakes you up first thing. It's the last thing you see before you go to bed. Right? And but there's just all this care that takes place because we have that dog, that pet. Well, there's a great little book written about 50 years ago. It's called A Shepherd Looks at Psalm 23. Some of you might have seen this. And it's written by a true shepherd. His name was Philip Keller. He was a shepherd here in the States and also in Africa, and he worked with sheep. And so what he does is he takes you through Psalm 23 line by line to show you how every one of those verses and all those words really do exemplify what a shepherd does. And so what we're going to do here is, first, do you remember the first line of Psalm 23? I bet you do. Say it. Say the last line. Something about what? Something about forever. Okay, we got forever. What? The pastor doesn't count. Somebody else. Say it. John? Very good. Thank you. From out of the mouth of babes. There you go. So I got a few things I want to share with you about from that book. But just to put it in your mind, we're going to really focus on just the last line. But to understand the last line, we're going to read through the rest of it together, okay? So I think we got Psalm 23 that we can put up here. And let's just read through it, and we'll start verse 1. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Very good. So he says, as you follow along with this book, he says it's no surprise, no surprise, if you pay attention to the beginning and the middle of that psalm, that the last line says, "And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Will dwell in his presence forever. Because there's two things that stand out from Psalm 23. One is the diligent, all-consuming, careful, alert, aware concern and care that the shepherd has for the sheep. Remember all the things I just shared about our dog? Just a handful of things about caring for a pet. But when you read all those lines of Psalm 23, one thing that stands out is the diligent care of the shepherd in all aspects of our life. The second thing that should stand out when you read through that is, don't you want that? As a sheep that we are, don't you want and aren't you drawn to that kind of a shepherd who is so careful in the way he looks out for us, so diligent in the way he cares for us? There's this longing and this care that the shepherd has for the sheep, and it makes the sheep long for that shepherd even more. So here's what the book ends with. Put this on the screen, I believe. It says, "For when all is said and done on the subject of a successful Christian walk, it can be summed up in one sentence: live ever aware of God's presence." A successful time of following Jesus, living ever aware of God's presence. A few days ago, Sunday night, we talked about how to be in His presence. Gave you three things. Number one was remember His promises. Number two was to earnestly desire it. And then finally, just to be still. If you want to practice His presence, remember His promises, desire it, want it from your heart. But then you got to be still and have moments of quiet and solitude where the radio's not on, the TV's not on, your phone's not near you. Maybe nobody else is near you, and be still before God. So we talked about how to be in His presence. Today we're going to spend just a moment talking about the benefits of living ever aware of God's presence. The benefits of being aware of His presence. Number one, first of all, His presence is our conscience for our behavior. His sweet Spirit that indwells us is at times affirming what we're doing and blessing us because we're following Him. And at other times, that same sweet Spirit is kind of tapping us on the shoulder, telling us when we've gone astray, like all sheep go astray. Living ever aware of His presence makes us conscious of our behavior. It lets us know when we're on the right track, and it helps us when we veer off. It helps us know how to get back on. So His presence is our conscious for our behavior. That's one of the benefits. The second benefit is His presence is our power to follow Him in the first place. We can't do this successful Christian walk or life on our own. We weren't made to do it on our own. We weren't made to pull ourselves up by our bootstraps. We're made to live in the power of His Spirit, living ever aware of His presence. And the Spirit works in cooperation with us to be able to do that. Number three, third thing, I said these were going to be quick. His presence is our contentment and security in every circumstance. I like that one. Because I know some of you are wrestling with this. Because of things going on in your life, circumstances happening, COVID stuff from the last year and a half. Anxiety's gone way up. Worry has gone up. Some of you are dealing with health, work, family issues. His presence, when we're living ever aware of it, His presence is our contentment and security in every circumstance. Because we live surrounded by His presence. It's not just with us. It's around us. Our every thought, decision, and action are already open to Him. He already knows them. And you know what? He's not ever once shied away from us. He's never once ran away from us. In fact, the story of the prodigal son, the father runs to us when we've been away. He attends to us with every care and concern because He loves us and we belong to Him for all eternity. This is our assurance that we will dwell in the house of the Lord forever in His presence. An interesting thought about this, Joel preached on Luke chapter 5 as we're going through Luke. He preached on part of it Sunday. One of the stories in Luke 5 that he didn't include was the story of the paralyzed man whose friends take him to that home where Jesus is teaching, doing his thing, and it's all crowded. They can't get in, remember, and the crowd of the friends go up on the roof, and they dig a hole through the roof, and they lower the paralyzed man in through the roof. Think about the homeowner. We're talking about living everywhere of God's presence in our home this week. Think about that homeowner. Imagine what he was willing to do and what he went through to have Jesus, the presence, His presence in his home. He was willing to welcome all these strangers in. He was willing to welcome, they had to practice hospitality back then. That was just a part of their culture. And shame if they didn't. So imagine all the hospitality he had to provide to all those people in some way. He had to deal with destruction of his home. And he had to deal with a lot of sacrifices. Who knows what they left behind? What kind of mess once they left that day? So what are you willing to sacrifice or give up or destroy in your life to have more of His presence in your life? Yeah, His presence, Jesus' presence that day, made the man conscious of his behavior. Because he looked at him and said, "Your sins are forgiven. Take up your mat and go home." Jesus' power was made manifest in that home. And he brought contentment and security to at least the paralyzed man and probably his friends once they left. His presence is our conscience for our behavior. It's His power for us to follow Him. And it's our security and contentment through every circumstance. Those are the benefits that He leaves with us. And if you've read that story before, you may remember, what did Jesus tell the man to do when he left? He said, "Go to your home. Take the consciousness of my presence, take the power of my presence, take the serenity and contentment that you've just experienced and take it to your own home and tell them about me." Jesus had him go to his home first because he wanted him to experience the presence of Jesus in his home first. And that's why this week we're focusing on just living in His presence, ever aware of His presence in our home. So I tell you what, we're having a prayer service, so we're going to pray. And if you want to bow your heads, we're going to spend a little bit of time praying and just thinking through, meditating on these three ideas. The benefits of living ever aware of His presence. So as you kind of find a quiet place there, a still place, I want you to think first on His presence being your conscience for your behavior. Where is He telling you? Just listen for Him now. Is He telling you about a place or something in your life that you're doing well? What's He affirming you on right now? And maybe there's something that He's convicting you of as well, that you need to ask for forgiveness for, that you need to apologize to somebody about. Take a moment and consider His presence being our conscience. Second thing was that His presence is our power to follow Him. Where are you struggling right now? Have a talk with the Lord. Tell Him where you're struggling. Tell Him where you need His presence to give you power to live in. Is it something at work? Is it something at home? Is it something in your family? Ask Him to be present with you and to give you the power to walk obediently through that. The third thing was that His presence brings us contentment and security in every circumstance. Spend a moment with the Lord just asking for where your life has worry and stress, anxiety, where you need calm. Will you just ask Him to come and visit you and be with you in that place where you need that contentment and security? Thank you for taking the time to do that. If you were here Sunday night, Marshall and Brittany did a great job of leading us through a series of prayers around the idea of repentance and some thoughts about repentance. And as we come together to pray tonight, our prayer theme is going to be one of thanksgiving. That's why we sang 10,000 Reasons. And as you're sitting there, I'd ask you to go ahead and start thinking of things that you're thankful for. What blessings have you had because of the Lord? What things in your life are you thankful for? Let those start streaming through your mind as we talk here for just a little bit. Our theme verse for our 21 days is 1 Chronicles 16:11, which says, "Seek the Lord and His strength. Seek His presence continually." The context of that verse is actually kind of a longer passage on the thankfulness that David and Israel was feeling at that time. You see, they had just gotten back into Jerusalem, the Ark of the Covenant. Through a series of battles with the Philistines, the Ark of the Covenant, which kind of signified the presence of the Lord, because it was this gold box, and on top it was this kind of two angels facing one another, these cherubim, and it was said that the presence of the Lord would meet in between those cherubim. And it was stolen. The Philistines took it away, one of their conquests in battle for a period of time, and eventually the Israelites were able to bring it back and bring it back to the Israelites. And out of joy, David kind of asked someone, and they responded with this big, long hymn, basically, of thanksgiving and praise because they had the presence of the Lord back. And that's where that verse 11 is from. But I've asked some folks to read for us the context of the rest of those verses, and Skye's going to start us off. So, Skye, you can use, you're sitting over here, you can use that microphone. I believe it's turned on. And she's going to read to you the first number of verses around verse 11, from 8 all the way to 24. And just listen to the joy that is back in the midst of Israel because the presence of the Lord is back. Go ahead, Skye. Thank you.
Give praise to the Lord. Proclaim His name. Make known among the nations what He has done. Sing to Him. Sing to praise Him. Tell all of His wonderful acts. Glory is in His holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Look to the Lord in His strength. Seek His face always. Remember the wonders He has done, His miracles, and the judgments He pronounced. You, His servants, the descendants of Israel, His chosen ones, the children of Jacob. He is the Lord our God. His judgments are in all the earth. He remembers His covenant forever, the promise He made for 1,000 generations, the covenant He made with Abraham, and the oath He swore to Isaac. He confirmed it to Jacob as a decree, to Israel as an everlasting covenant. To you I will give the land of Canaan as a proportion you will inherit. When they were but few in number, few indeed, and strangers in it, they wandered from nation to nation, from one kingdom to another. He allowed no one to oppress them. For their sake He rebuked kings. Do not touch My anointed ones. Do My prophets no harm. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Proclaim His salvation day after day. Declare His glory among the nations, His marvelous deeds among all people.
Declare His marvelous deeds among all the people. Thank you very much, Scott. Great job. You know, what's interesting about, and that's just the first part of it. There's still a second half to that little passage there. And what's interesting is they didn't just write about how great it was to have the ark back. It made them think about all the marvelous deeds that God had done before. And they started listing out some of these things as a reminder to themselves and to the people of how God had followed through and will be with them forever. And all the things that the Lord has done in their lives. So here's what we're going to do. together as a family here. There's two mics here, and we'd love for you to be thankful to the Lord out loud, if you so desire. There's a couple ways that you can do that. Just by simply coming up, and maybe you just want to thank him for something that's happened in your life recently or in the past. You know, the passages this guy read, they went through hundreds of years of Thanksgiving there. You may have many years of Thanksgiving that you'd like to share with us. So you might have just something that's happened in your life you want to give thanks to God for. You may have a story that you'd like to tell of how he's come through for you. You'll see there's two little baskets there. Those are, there's some verses of Thanksgiving in there. So if it makes you nervous to think of your own thing, but you want to say something, you can just pick one of those things out of the basket and just read them. But let's just take a few moments, as long as it takes, and give him thanks publicly for all of his marvelous deeds and marvelous works that he's done for us. So whenever someone's ready that would like to go first, either side's fine.
Thankful for the fellowship that believers have with one another, that we can meet a stranger in a place we've never been and have that bond that Christians have. I've been to countries where I didn't share the language with someone, and yet I could feel the kinship of being believers, and I'm thankful for that.
Great job. Thank you. Amen.
For my family and just the new job I've started. I just recently moved to the community, and we didn't know in the last few months, we didn't know how we pay our rent. We had two rents this month. We didn't know how we pay our rent and all that. All our Christmas money that we got paid one rent. And then we got here, our landlord, our house wasn't finished, and he's like, yeah, I'm not going to charge you that rent. You just owe me $200. So you don't have to pay rent. So somehow the Lord provided, thankfully, and I'm thankful for that.
Thank you, Tessa.
I'm going to have to boss this thing, but it's just to get it up high enough. I'm going to publicly thank God for my wife. I had a career plan many years ago, and God gave me another offering, and he said, hey, you want to come chase me? And I said, okay. And along the way, he led me to her. And it took me a while to wake up and go, hey, John, I got you a helpmate over here. But I did, finally, and I thank him for that opportunity because she has been the most perfect support, the most perfect mate. She has continually called me to my better self. She pours out her grace not only to me, but to my children, our children, and my job is not the world's easiest, and I'm probably not the easiest person to live with. And yet, even when I'm hurting or I'm stressed out, she has continued to show me grace and redirect me to God in ways that I really don't see how she does it. And I am a better man for her, and I know my Father God, so much better because of her grace to me. And I want to thank you for that.
When I was about a baby or something, I was horribly beat by my biological mom and taken out of my home with my only sister that I grew up with knowing. And I was in horrible foster homes. And then when I was 1.5, me and Stormy got adopted. Then our adopted mom's mom died. And then we started getting physically and mentally abused very badly. And it started getting worse when our adopted dad died when I was 11. And then Stormy developed her Tourette's by the trauma and everything that happened. And like Jancy said, God loves us. He will punish us though. And I just forgive her for what she did to me, even though she did something she shouldn't have done in the first place. I was abused from 5th grade to last year. Then I went to my aunt's care. She mentally abused me a lot, never Stormy. And I felt I was about to blame God for what happened, but I didn't, because I know he loves me and Stormy, even though Stormy doesn't know that. But I just don't want to see my adopted mom in court for what she did. It's awful. But I still love God, even though what happened to me and Stormy.
Thank you, Sky. His love is the same, whether it's sunny or raining in our lives. So here's what I'd like us to do next. You're some of you sitting with family members, some of you sitting with friends, and I'd like you to get together with the people you're sitting next to, could be in a family, grab the person that's maybe solo near you, and just say a little Thanksgiving prayer together. Maybe you just want to do it as your family or as a couple. That's fine too. But just say a little Thanksgiving prayer. Not everybody has to do it in your circle. It might just be one person. But just grab the people around you that you're with or near and give your own thanks. Okay? Take a moment just to do that. It's okay. All right, if you'll head back to your seats. Thank you for taking the time to do that. Caleb? I mentioned earlier that Sky just read the first part of all those praises and all those thanksgivings that they wrote back when the presence came back, the presence of the Lord came back to them. So Caleb is going to finish that off from 1 Chronicles chapter 16. Caleb, go ahead. Thank you.
For great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. He is to be feared above all gods, for all the gods of the nations are idols. But the Lord made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and joy are in his dwelling place. Ascribe to the Lord all your families of nations. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come before him. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth. The world is firmly established. It cannot be moved. Let the heavens rejoice. Let the earth be glad. Let them say among the nations, the Lord reigns. Let the sea resound and all that is in it. Let the fields be jubilant and everything in them. Let the trees of the forest sing. Let them sing for joy before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Cry out, save us, God our Savior. Gather us and deliver us from the nations, that we may give thanks to your holy name and glory in your praise. Praise be to the Lord of God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Then all the people said amen and praised the Lord.
Amen and praise the Lord. Well, you know, when a list is read like that, or when you mention the things that you've mentioned here tonight, we can say thanks because we know that we have a good Father. He's good. Even in the hard times, even in the midst of things that don't make sense, that we can't control, that we wish were different, he's a good Father. He cares for us. He loves us. Before you leave, we're gonna sing another song. We're kind of gonna do what we did Sunday night. I'm gonna ask some of our ministry leaders to gather around the room, elders or life group leaders or women's leaders or anybody that's here. And if you need somebody to pray for you about something privately, they would love to do that. And so as we're singing, they're gonna be up here, and you're welcome to go to them in prayer. And then once the song's done, it's going to fade out and there's going to be some other music playing, but you can stick around as long as you need to, or you can leave whenever you need to. It's up to you when the service is over for you. If you still need to be in here to thank him for some things, be prayed for about something, we ask that you take advantage of that. And I'll say for next Wednesday, it will probably be helpful to you to bring a journal or something that you like to take notes in, or think of, write down things that God's done or showed you. I invite you to bring something to write with and to write on next week because of the different things that we're going to be doing. Next Wednesday's going to look a lot different. So we're excited about that. So just wanted to give you a forewarning. Those of you at home, thank you for worshiping with us today as well. Being a part of just focusing on living ever aware of God's presence. We can do that in our homes, where we work, and where we play. So let's sing this one last song together about our good Father. And if you would like to be prayed for, there'll be people available who will be glad to pray over you. Thank you. Join in.
Thousand stories of what they
take your life, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, and I've seen many searching for answers far.
It's who I am. It's who I am.